What's the first line of code that runs in your game? Say you wanted something to happen at the very start, maybe initialize some saved data, set up some global variables. Where would you put that code? It's a question that almost every single dev will ask at some point, but it leads to a bigger question. How does code execute at all? It often surprises new developers that all code in their project executes in a very specific order and one line at a time. Nothing in GameMaker happens at the same time as anything else, whether it's moving a character by updating its X and then its Y, or drawing multiple sprites in the draw event one after another. It all happens in order. In this video, I'm going to map how code executes so that you can code confidently, knowing exactly when things happen and in what order. However, it may not always be as predictable as you might like. Let's talk about it. Back to that first question. Where would you put code that you wanted to guarantee happened before anything else? Maybe you'd put it in the create event of the first instance in the first room of your game. Maybe you'd put it in the room creation code of that same room. What about the code you put in scripts? When does that get run? Let's do some experimentation and find out. Throughout this project, I have spread some show debug message calls so we can track the order in which the code executes. If we look at the room, the creation code has a show debug message, the object's create event has a show debug message, and the scripts each have two, one inside the function and one outside the function. Additionally, I'm calling each function from the other script. This will be important later. When I run the game, we can hunt for these messages in the output log. That will give us a good idea of the order code is executed when we start our game. So let's run it. The first one we see is the room creation code. Since that's at the bottom of our list, that means it was the last one to run. It even comes after the create event for objects in the room. So this isn't going to work as a place to put code I want running right at the start. Personally, I'm not a big fan of the room creation code anyway. I almost never use it. It feels too isolated to me. So I'm glad to see it's not terribly useful for this. The next one we see is the instance create event. This honestly isn't too bad, especially since you can control the order that these events run using the instance creation order panel. So you really can directly control the order these create events happen if you need to. We have to scroll up quite a bit to see our next set, the scripts. And something really interesting is happening here. Rather than rely on our debug messages, let's use breakpoints. A breakpoint will allow us to use the debugger to pause the game's code right before the line with the breakpoint executes. Then we can step through each line of code one at a time to see the order it all happens in. So I'll set a breakpoint at the top of script 1 and run in debug mode. The first line defines the script 1 function. I'm going to press F11, which is the shortcut for this step into button, to execute that line of code and go to the next line, show debug message. Then we run script 2. Wait a minute. Now we are in the script 2 function, but script 2 hasn't even been ran yet. How is this function even valid? It shouldn't have even been defined yet, right? Here, let's set a second breakpoint on line 1 of script 2 and try again. F11, into script 2. Yep, we're inside the function before the line that supposedly defines it is ever ran. Just to make sure, let's press F11. Okay, back in script 1, and F11 one more time, and we are finally in script 2. But how is this possible? How can we execute a function that is in a script that itself hasn't been executed yet? Isn't the script responsible for defining that function? Well, yes and no. Obviously, we need to write the function definition in the script, otherwise the function just doesn't exist. But it's not the execution of the script at the start of the game that defines the function and makes it available for you to use. This process happens even earlier, before the code and script assets is executed. GameMaker will scan every script for global function declarations and put all of those functions into memory for you to use anywhere in your game. So technically, when we hit this breakpoint on line 1 of our scripts, that line of code isn't really doing anything and is mostly just getting skipped at this point. It's already been used by a previous process to define the function. And that's why we can call any function defined in any script at any time, anywhere, without issue. But that brings up another question. Why does script 1 execute at game start before script 2? Is it the order they were created in? Is it because of the 1 or the 2 in the name? Ultimately, that answer doesn't matter. As of recording, you cannot reliably control which script will execute its loose code, code outside of function definitions, before others. So we have a bit of a problem. The best place to put code that will run at the start of your game is in a script resource. But how do you choose which script if you can't control the order they execute in? Here's what I recommend. Have one startup or initialization script. This is the only script in your entire project that has code outside of function declarations. You can call as many global functions as you want, in the exact order you want, and initialize global variables. And all that will happen before your game actually starts and the object events run. Object events? We all know that generally speaking, if you want your game to do anything, you need to put some code in an object event. And as I said earlier, all code in GM happens in order, one line at a time. But if you have lots of objects and lots of events in those objects, in what order is all that code executing? Is it predictable? Can that order be manipulated at all? Let's switch up this example project a bit to help us explore that. I have an object with a lot of events in it. In each event, I have a show debug message that spits out the object name, the instance ID, and the name of the event, or at least the category of the event. There are a lot of individual events. I also happen to know, for a fact, that the last event that is ever ran for any object is the draw GUI end event. So, after spitting out the message in there, I call instance destroy so that my console doesn't get spammed with the same thing 60 times every second, and we can look at the results. So I'll place an instance of this object in my room and run the game. Now, let's see what we have in the console. Interesting. So we can see the create event happens very first, way up even before we enter the main loop, which is expected. But once we get into the main loop, there's a whole mishmash of events between begin step and end step, alarms, keyboard input, collision checks, etc. And there's a lot more than just the few events I've put show debug messages in. We can also see that pre-draw happens before any draw events, obviously, but post-draw happens before any draw GUI events. That's kind of interesting. However, we aren't seeing the hidden events. Hidden events happen automatically between some events. There are several of these black boxes, and they do all sorts of things. For example, there's one between the step and end step event that handles all the built-in motion variables like how your X and Y change automatically based on your current H speed and V speed. X previous and Y previous also get updated here. Another, that happens even before the begin step, updates your image index based on your sprite's animation speed and the instance's image speed. You have no control over how these hidden events execute for the most part. If your instance is not deactivated, it's going to perform these operations automatically. Beyond these mysterious hidden events, the rest of this is pretty straightforward. It should be obvious that begin step happens before step, and step happens before end step. And if you are ever curious about the order of any two specific events, you can always repeat this exact same experiment on your own. But things get more complicated when you have more than one instance. Let's add a couple more instances to the room and run again. Notice how each event is executed on every instance before it moves on to the next event type. This is really important. Every instance runs the code in the begin step, then every instance runs the alarm event code, then every instance runs the key down, then the key press, and so on. So you can always be sure that for any given frame, an instance will execute its begin step code before any instance gets a chance to run its step or end step code. But what about different instances that have the code in the same event? Which one goes first? In this example, logic events, which is what I call all the events from begin step to end step, are executed by each instance in this order. Instance 3, then 1, then 2, always that same order. But why? Why that order?
Well,
It just so happens to be the order they were created in. However, I highly recommend not relying on that. This is called undocumented behavior, something that seems consistent, but there's no clear documentation that tells you it can be relied on. It might seem predictable, but it can change out from under you at any time. It might work differently when building for a different platform or when you update GM to a new version. So for the safety and reliability of your project, you should always code with the belief and understanding that you cannot control which instances run the code for a particular logic event before other instances. You can never be sure that instance A will run its step event before instance B runs its step event. Instead, rely on the order of the events themselves. If you have an object that must run its step event before another object's step event, then you should use a combination of begin step, step, and end step to control the execution order. It's not the only way to do it, but it is one of the most straightforward ways. I said logic event execution order can't be predicted. What about not logic events? Draw events, which are all the events from pre-draw to draw GUI end, follow the same basic rules. Each event type is executed on every instance before moving on to the next event type. So draw begin happens on all instances before any instance gets to execute the draw event. But again, what about two instances that use the same event? Let's look at that list again. Notice that the order that the instances execute the draw events is different from the step events. That's because the instances are sorted by depth before each draw event is executed. Yes, before each draw event is executed. That means you can change depth in the draw event, and the draw end event will respect it. I don't know how useful that information is. I honestly didn't realize that until I sat down to research for this video, but there it is. To summarize all of this, we can map out the execution of our game's code like this. Each logic event is executed per instance in an unpredictable order, one at a time. Then the instances are sorted by depth before each individual draw event, and the event code for each instance is executed one at a time in that order. Similar to logic events, if two instances have the same depth, there is no reliable way to predict which one comes before the other. So again, use depth or the event order to control what happens when. I sort of glossed over something a little while ago. Let's go back to the first list of events I showed. In the draw GUI end event of this object, I call instance destroy. The destroy event, by default, fires immediately for the destroyed instance, and then after the destroy event, the cleanup event automatically fires. If I put another show debug message after the instance destroy call, that message would show up after the cleanup event has fired. Both the destroy and cleanup events are sort of special. They don't happen at a set point in the event order queue, but instead happen immediately in response to something. I've been destroyed. I need to run my destroy event and then my cleanup event. In a way, these events work more like methods than your typical events that happen every step. Just something to keep in mind. One thing that may be a bit unintuitive and catches a lot of people off guard is what happens when you create an instance in the middle of another instance's event. The most common example is like creating a bullet in the step event of a player or a gun object because the fire button was pressed. Let's look at that situation a little closer. I've got a player object and a bullet object. In the step event of my player, if the spacebar is pressed, I create a bullet object. The bullet object has two events, step and end step. Let's put a breakpoint in both the step and end step of the bullet object, and then a breakpoint in the player when we create the bullet. When I press the spacebar, we hit our breakpoint. But before I press the play button to continue code execution, pause the video and answer this question to yourself. Which breakpoint in the bullet will be hit first, the step event or the end step event? Got an answer? Okay, when we press play, end step. The bullet was created in the step event of the player object, but it did not get to execute its step event this frame. Got totally skipped. If I had logic in my step event that I needed to run before end step or even the draw events, I might have had some sort of weird visual issue for a single frame, or in the worst case, the game might have crashed. So keep that in mind when deciding which events to put code in for objects you plan on creating while your game is running. So I could probably make this video an hour long, going through every single event and shedding light on every edge case. But the real lesson here is how to experiment and discover these things for yourself. So instead of more video, you've got... The create event is pretty straightforward. Happens right when you call instance create or at the start of a room in the creation order you can control. But there are some things that can complicate it. When do variable definitions get applied to an instance? What about the last argument of instance create? What about instance creation code that you can add to instances in the room editor? What order do all of these things happen relative to each other? What about room start and room end events? Those ones are kind of weird. How do those work? Does it matter which event you call room go to in? How does changing rooms affect how persistent objects execute events? Go experiment with this stuff, just like I have in this video, and be willing to explore these questions in a fresh project whenever you encounter issues. Hopefully you found this video useful. If you have any questions, I recommend joining the GM Discord server and asking there. There's a link in the description. Thanks for watching, now go make something awesome.